Hello everyone. Thank you for joining in. I am Pratik Poddar, and on behalf of Nexus team, I would like to welcome all of you to the webinar. Nexus is an early stage venture fund investing in product-led startups across India and US. We are the first investors in many category defining companies like White Hat Junior, Postman, Unacademy, Dhruva, Delivery, Paysense, and many others. Anup and I had the privilege of partnering with Karan from the concept stage. Karan and White Hat need no introduction. White Hat is a category creating company in the Indian startup ecosystem. Karan has a unique background. He's a yogi, a meditator, author of bestseller books, and previously CEO of Discovery India. Over the next hour, we would discuss his journey right from coming up with the idea, the key decisions he took while building the company, and a decision to exit. I'm sure all of you are looking forward to today's session. It'd be great to get your questions. Please send them through the Q&A box on your Zoom window. We'll try to get as many questions answered as possible in the given time frame. With this, I would like to hand it over to Anup Gupta, Managing Director at Nexus, who is hosting today's Conversation with Nexus session featuring Karan Bajaj. Anup, over to you.
Thank you, Pratik. Good evening. Welcome everyone to this session. Karan, thank you for joining us today. I'm going to go back and start going back about 2 years ago to the inception of White Hat. And one aspect which has always stood in my mind, Karan, was the clarity of your thoughts even at the idea stage. So maybe you want to start by asking, how did you go about ideation to get that kind of a clarity?
Sure, but let me start by saying thank you. Thank you to Nexus. I think I haven't officially got a chance to say it in any forum. I think a lot of the noise around the acquisition has been my background and stuff like that. But I think what is underleveraged is that really just exactly 2 years ago, we were a PowerPoint presentation, right? I think a lot of credit goes to, I think Anup, you and your team, obviously, for recognizing something there, right? Which was really truly a PowerPoint presentation. So I think, a lot of the credit for any success of the company has gone to the fact that you allowed me to build a team very quickly with the first investment. And believed in the product. So thank you for doing that. And I'm very happy.
Thank you.
So on ideation, I would say the kind of the philosophy that I have typically is that, I think it comes from my novel writing heritage a little bit, right? Everybody has an idea for a novel, but very few people write it, right? So in general, my feeling is that I don't ideate much, right? Anytime I have any kind of an idea, I immediately execute it, right? So before I'd met you, which was around this time only, September of October, 2 years ago, in July is actually the first time I'd come up with the idea. And I think within a couple of weeks of that, I'd put up a website, right, with a guy from Upwork. And then I'd gotten the first employee, Gauri, who eventually became the first employee I just called her and said like, hey, would you do some coding classes for kids? And I'll put up a Facebook post about it. And if people pay money, then I know that the idea is good, right? So that's how I started. So I think within a couple of weeks of having first come up with the idea, I executed it in its very bare form. And by the time I met you, like I think another couple of weeks after that, probably I had a pretty good understanding that people were buying it, right? And this is the reason why they were buying it. And that's why that allowed me to create a plan. So I think the general philosophy has been, anytime you have an idea, just execute it. I think my team also kind of jokes a little bit that anytime they come to me with something, my first question is, kal subha kya kar rahe hain types. The point is that, look, if you have this idea, let's break it down to the simplest version that can be executed within this week sort of a thing, right? And that's how we learn. So it was very similar, right? At that point of time, it was, and even then, once we met you and then the funding discussion happened, we launched the first version of the product, like even within 6 weeks or so after that also. So I think the whole journey was about the moment you have something, figure out what's the simplest version and just put it out there. And the moment you put it out there, then the learning starts about, how to kind of build it forward. Yeah.
Very interesting. So you're saying put out an early version and then see how the relevant customer base is reacting to it and then go on from there.
Correct. Exactly. So I think from the time I came up with the idea, July 15th, I think around August first week is, so that's really about, say, I would say 2.5 weeks from then, I had a basic landing page up, which a guy from Upwork had done. I had the first eventual employee at that time. I just called from my friends. I figured out if anybody knew coding for childhood. I called her and said, look, can you take some classes? I'm just going to put it on Facebook. I put a post on my own Facebook saying coding classes for kids, right? And people signed up. And then we connected her to Gauri, the teacher. And after the first trial class, surprisingly enough, that same model exists at this scale now, right? At a $200 million case, that there was a trial class which was free. And then at that time, the Gauri just asked them for money, right, to for the rest of the classes, which they had to transfer to her own bank account, right? And yeah, I didn't take my cut from that.
Got it. And a related aspect, so did you spend much time thinking about market size? I know there were many questions on the what's the scale of this overall opportunity. It looks very obvious now, but was not at all obvious at that point. What would be your advice to founders as they are thinking about their ideas and potential size of the opportunity?
I think the right question to ask is not how big the category is. I think in some way or the other, and I'll put the names out there, right? I'll give credit to your thinking at that time, the entire Nexus's team thinking. When I came up with the idea, I think the question you guys were asking was very different from what, for example, Axel asked me. If I remember the first set of people that I had met that time, right? They were asking ki how big is the category, right? So the question was, how many Google searches are happening on the category? I think the question you asked is this guy capable of building the category, right? And I had the very similar thesis, right? My point was, look, the category doesn't exist, right? The question is this category buildable, right? Can I build this category, right? And I had a very good conviction then that, look, at its core, an edtech product has to do just two things well, right? It has to be very delightful for kids, and it has to show extreme value to a parent, right? And I was very confident that coding for kids is very delightful for kids, right? Because they are, and the core thesis of the product was that kids would be become builders and creators, right? They would be creators for life. And I knew kids love building stuff, right? That's age old. So they'll kind of create. So they'll be delighted. And then parent value, I learn and like be able to build. And that question, I would say, it kept coming up, right? Because I remember the first time we hit 1 crore a month of revenue was June of 2019, right? After that, the next month, I think the revenue started to flatten at about 1 crore, right? And then we asked the question on, are we communicating value to the parent, right? And at that time, the marketing message was that coding improves logic 75% and so, right? We went around the room and we said, okay, to the moms in the room, right? We asked the question, what do you really want for your kid, right? And the truth is that parents wanted extraordinary success for the kid. They wanted their kid to be a novelist. They wanted, at the heart, they would say, I want my kid to be happy. But when you unpeeled it, they wanted extraordinary success for the kid. So then we correlated coding to success, right? We said CEO at age 12, all of that kind of like stuff in marketing, that really shot up the category. Then again, when we hit a wall, we again said, okay, what does it take to build this category? So I think the right question to ask is the first principle question of what does it take to build the category? And then how can you keep offering that, right? And we kept offering higher and higher forms of parent value and
building. Absolutely. Yeah, and I remember our early discussions. I think essentially what you're saying is that if you're doing something new as an entrepreneur, focus on what value you're adding to your consumers. And if that value is deep enough, there is a large
Correct.
In most cases, there's a large opportunity to be captured.
Yeah. And combined with launching early, see for now, for example, it's so effective right now. We are still doing that, right? Surprisingly enough, even at this stage, we keep every 6 weeks, a net promoter score goes to the customer. Even now we are understanding, okay, the net promoter, even at the 70, 80 mark of net promoter score, we are looking at the detractor comments and we are saying that, look, now, for example, the new thing that we are working on is that parents don't understand. They see a lot of benefit in how their kid's mind is expanding, but they don't know the why. Like, why is it happening? And so we are doing a complete asynchronous video course almost for the parents, right? So that journey of like understanding how can you increase the value constantly never ends. And that's why I believe so much ki launch it early. Users give you the feedback and then you can like really like keep building value for them based on that feature, based on what they give you feedback on. Yeah.
So that's a great segue into my next discussion topic. You as you said, I think more than any founder, I've seen you focus on monetization from day one, and even with a very very early product. What are is easier than said than done, obviously. What are some of the things one has to do to scale monetization along with product development? In fact, essentially, you are selling something which you have not fully built out. I remember in the beginning, we had not even built all the curriculum for whatever 20, 30 classes and when people were signing up for those kind of packages.
Right, right. I never saw a conflict between monetization and product. In a way, See, monetization was a bit given with my background. I was just coming. I was a CEO of Discovery before that. I'd ran P&Ls all my life. So I couldn't imagine a business which didn't have a P&L. So it never later, you know, like after I got into it, I realized all of the startup wisdom around, you know, that once the users comes, revenue will come. But I could not think of a business without a P&L, right? So right off the gate, I was always thinking of what is the P&L of this business, right? Where is the revenue? What is the cost? It was very fundamental in my thinking. So then I never asked the question on giving, let's do it for free and build users and then do monetize. I was always clear that we would monetize. And off the gate, I think the question we always ask is, what is the simplest version of the product that people would pay for? And in the beginning, the question was that they would pay for a live class in which the kid would code with the assistance of a teacher. So we kind of took a Jitsi, which was like an open source video platform. We took an, because we didn't have that much money to kind of do a Zoom B2B account or whatever. We took an open source video platform. We built our own PDF of coding classes. We took code.org coding platform. We put it together and we said that the customer is going to pay for the teacher doing the one-on-one class, right? And that was the simplest version of the product, was a video platform and code.org, right? And we trained the teacher and she delivered it. And then after that, we kept scaffolding it with features, right? We launched, we realized the customers wanted flexible scheduling. Then we built a scheduling engine. Then we said, okay, the customer wants, now when I look at the product, it's evolved so much. There is gamification, there is community for kids. The earliest version of the product that people were paying for was a video class on coding, right? And they paid for it. And then subsequently we kept scaffolding it with more and more features.
The debate I guess many founders have is that one needs to get a basic product with some basic UI, some basic value before you put it out there. And I know in our case,
right.
Product, actually one can argue the UI was non-existent almost.
Right.
It was a teacher teaching a kid, but the content was very rock solid.
Yeah, right? Correct.
So
yeah.
How did you ever get concerned that you're putting a product out there which is like very, 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 very rudimentary and might
actually no, I was very confident because I thought that the people were paying for a coding class for kids. Right. And yes, it should be aesthetically pleasing to look at. But so if you remember the first six employees of the company, right, which will till about March of last year. In fact, there were only six people in the company now. I mean, obviously, it's a different scale. But at that time, there were three curriculum creators and three tech people. Right. We didn't have a UI designer, etc. So there was just three designers, front end, back end, and like a full stack guy. And then there were three curriculum creators who were all extremely solid. Right. And so we knew that, look, the people are paying for the coding curriculum and then they are paying for the video and our video should connect the teacher and the student and the curriculum creators doubled up as teacher trainers and all of that stuff, right? So we knew that the core proposition was a live teacher with a very engaging curriculum and we just did that. We didn't the people, I found consumers very forgiving about buttons and designs and colors and right, very, very forgiving as long as the core prop that they're paying for is rock solid. The first product, I feel embarrassed about because I would call it a mistake of the company that the first product guy and the first designer was hired in the company in October of last year. So, you know, so when we were doing like about a couple of crores a month of revenue, right, we were very slow on that, I would say, you know, so I won't be very proud about, but I would say the customers cut us so much slack that for a year, it was like a patched up product, right? Because we were doing the content very well, the curriculum very well, which is what they were paying for and the teacher training.
So what you're saying is as an entrepreneur, really force yourself to think about what is the core value prop in your offering that value prop has to be
rock solid.
And then everything else around it is really
very forgiving. Customers are unbelievably forgiving, right? Like they would call the call center line and I would pick up and they like, you know, we were obviously a very patchy operation as can be expected. Now we have call centers and stuff running, but that time, you know, like they were very forgiving because the core proposition was very rock solid and very innovative, right?
Very innovative, yeah.
The advantage of the category creator is that there is no Sharma ji to ye de rahe hain or Verma ji to ye de rahe. We had none of those benchmarks, right? Ki are hamare school mein to ye bahut, like the customers were like, okay, this is the only place I can get it. That was the advantage of a category creator. They cut us a lot of slack on everything non-core. And then we kept building it, right? We scaffolded it quickly. We kept building all the other stuff around it.
And by definition, the early customers who come in are the ones who really believe in the offering and really want to experiment with it. So I think goes to your point of them cutting you slack. So let's move on to a critical topic of team building, Karan. And I think one thing which I've always been, I would say, amazed and intrigued by, and I'm not talking about pre-Zoom days, of how you would meet someone, I would say, virtually for 45 minutes and for a very senior position, and you would reach a conclusion that this is a person I want or I don't want in my team. And compared to many folks, and I would myself put in that category, who, when we are recruiting for senior positions, you typically want to meet a person a couple of times, and a lot of intense internal thought goes in. So what are some of the things that you have you look for when you're doing, because you built an amazing team with this approach in a short period of time.
Yeah, and we were also in Bombay, so at that time of point, obviously attracting tech people and like the whole startup ecosystem was in Bangalore, right? So obviously much of the first conversations or the decisions were made on Zoom and stuff at that point itself. But see, I look at three things. Well, I would say the first thing is that I think after the conversation, I should get the feeling that in this subject that I'm hiring the person for, they should know much, much more than me, right? Completely, right? So when I'm hiring a CTO or if I'm hiring the operations head, then they should know more about operations and tech than I would ever be able to know. And that's very easy to gauge, right? That their level of expertise on this category is far higher than me on the particular stream of work, so that I'm not needed in this or I become redundant in this field. If the answer to that is yes, I think the second is that I know that my pace of working is very extreme and fast. And I think I have a particular philosophy, right? Which is that a startup should be compressing in a way 20 years of work in 4 years of work, right? That's kind of the reason why you join a startup. Can you hear me, Anup? Am I losing?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So kind of, I always have this philosophy that look, that startups should compress kind of 20 years of work in about 4 years of work, right? That's the niche. Yeah, sorry.
Go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, so with that in mind, I would always look for people who had the same kind of idea that they wanted to build things very fast and there was some reason to do it. Like Pranab, the CTO, he was just coming out of Fresh Menu. He wanted to build something that was very enduring and he hadn't been able to do that for the past few years. So I liked people who had that same extreme that let's compress 20 years of work in 4 years, right? And kind of be very completely driven end to end for that. And then the third thing is I would do references myself, right? That was very important. I still do it. So for all of my team, I call up the people myself for references. And I always ask that, would you rate this person in the top 1%, 5%, 10% of people that you worked with? And if the answer is anything less than top 5% of people I've worked with, I typically don't hire. So, but I do the references myself. I don't delegate it to a recruiter, right? My people, like the people who report to me, I call up the references myself and I'm like, I look at a history of, was it in the top 1 to 5% of people that you ever worked with? And typically I think I've never gone wrong with that generally. Yeah.
Got it. And do you spend much thinking about, oh, is this person going to gel with me? Or is this going to person gel with the culture? Or is your philosophy that if he's following that compression mentality of yours, everything else will work out.
In a way that everything else will work out, because I think people in compression are very no-nonsense. They are not, like they just want to kind of create value quickly, right? They don't want to like, so that's what I've seen is that, that they typically gel very well. Yeah.
Interesting. And on the same note, any thoughts to share with the founders on what's your approach to delegation and empowerment? I've noticed that you're comfortable with empowering very, very quickly, which many founders struggle with actually, even in later stages.
Yeah. I think I'm very like strong at like, what I say, delegation, not abdication, right? Which is like delegate, but don't abdicate, which means very quickly, like the moment they come, like I want them to, like first day onwards, I want them to be thrown into the deep end and take on problems, right? So my general philosophy is that thrown into the deep end, they'll do very well. So Pranab, like first day on, he was told to kind of rebuild the whole tech system. So I delegate, but I do reviews, right? On ops sales, I do daily reviews. And on product tech curriculum, on the fixed side, I do weekly reviews, right? And those reviews are very robust, right? I go into numbers and details and like milestones and stuff, right? So, but that's all. I do once a week review with product and tech, like a daily review with ops and sales.
Got it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I guess they're keeping a very, very intense focus on performance is critical.
Correct. Output orientation on like what has been accomplished this week, what has been like. So the reviews are very robust part of our everyday 10 o'clock. We look at about 60 metrics as a whole management team for 1 hour, right? Each and every metric is looked at and figured out. So that's a very important part of the culture that we review every day, review very deeply.
Good. Let's take some questions at this point. So I can see a lot of audience questions, and please keep them coming. So one question, Karan, for you is, how did you arrive at this pain point of coding and think of it worth solving? Was there a trigger which happened with you personally to attempt to solve this problem?
Two things. I think one is, when I kind of like liked this idea, when I started to read a little bit about early childhood coding, the research on that, right? One thing which was coming up again and again was that early experiments in MIT, Tufts, etc. was indicating that kids who code early, they have this very profound psychological shift that happens in their mind that I'm going to be a builder, a creator, right? Because they start to put things together, start to see outcomes come out of it. They start to feel really in control, right? They start to think that, look, everything in the world is an object which is created by someone and I can build too. And I was very moved by that, right? Because if I looked at my own life, right, I changed a lot after my first novel, right? So till 28, I was very typical. I am like Procter & Gamble. But around 28, I left my job, traveled, wrote a novel. After that, if I look at the last 10 years, they were very profoundly experimentative, creative. I was always in that rhythm of like building things, right? And I thought that was a very good part of life. So I wanted my kids to feel that way very early, that look that they are going to be builders and creators. So this was a classic. It was not a painkiller in the sense that people were not like in pain that there is no coding. It was a vitamin in the kind of the startup parlance, but I believe that I could make it a painkiller, like as a category.
Right? Yeah, so, I remember from the get-go, your philosophy of changing kids from creators to from consumers to creators of technology. I think that was a very deep philosophical insight. And even then, I know it's resonating with
with the parents, because they all know that, look, the kid is going to be consuming technology. It's all around you. It's the center of the household. But will they be consuming it, or will they kind of be the person who architects it, right? I think people got that message very quickly, very clearly. And the great news was that the way the articulation of that vision, creators versus consumers, is exactly how the course was designed. So a lot of our kind of success was because the kids pulled the course, right? We didn't have to push the course to the parent. The kids pulled the course very well.
Got it. And another question coming up is a couple of questions on the same theme. Are there any key metrics you were focused on in the early part of your journey?
Very strongly. I had three metrics that I was very, very closely watching, right? Because see, I'm by its nature an impatient person. I like to scale fast and stuff, but I was very patient in the beginning, right? I was looking for three metrics to hit success, right? The first one was that the net promoter score should hit 50, right? So till the time it hit 50, actually we didn't scale, right? That was very important to me. The NPS is world-class at 50 and I want to hit 50 in a limited base. Second thing I was looking for was that the renewal should hit 50%. I had built that into the business model of the company, and I knew that if the renewal didn't hit 50%, we would create a leaky funnel. And in fact, our first set of renewals were about 25-30%, right? We made a lot of feature development till we hit 50% in renewals. And then the third thing was that the funnel should become predictable, right? Out of the people who took a free trial, 10 to 12% would convert, right? Until the time it hit predictability in the funnel, again, we didn't scale. So those were the three metrics. The moment I hit those metrics, right, that the trial, free trial to paid conversion became predictable, the renewal rates became 50%, and the net promoter score, which obviously links to renewal, became 50. That's when, but then after we started scaling, then it was very uninhibited, right? I just kept doubling month on month. I never because I knew that the product we had created was very fundamentally solid. But in a way, I always feel that you should be very patient in the beginning. And then after you figure out something, though, you have to be on the exact extreme, right? You have to go completely impatient, because if you've created a product, people will knock it off, right? You lose your first mover advantage, right? We went so rapidly scaling that by the time people started to copy everything, it was a bit almost too late, right? Because we had just flooded the market overall with every ads, this, that, right? We had taken over the market.
So you're saying that in the beginning, it's important to be impatient to launch an early product.
Correct.
That's the core thesis, but to be patient to not get too caught up in scaling that.
Scaling the product, yeah. Because it's very tempting, right? You have some revenue, right? Revenue is exciting. You want to, you know, but you have to know that, look, if you create a leaky funnel, then you'll constantly be in the cycle of fundraising and this, right? Because you've not created a fundamentally robust business in which people are coming. They're coming back. Predictably, and the net promoter score, in very honesty, is like a number in which people are happy with the product, right? So with all of the kind of the noise, that the truth which has remained about the company is that the people are unbelievably happy. The users have always been kind of like, we've had refund rates have been so low, less than 3%. Renewal rates have been so strong that in the end, that what helped us was that if you look at it, we raised about $10 million, right? And we were hitting, at the time of the acquisition, we were hitting $150 million run rate, right? We were doing, bookings run rate, or we were doing about, at that point, now we're doing about $20 million of booking, right? And the reason why we've done that with such little cash is because the product was good. People told other people, customer acquisition costs lowered with time rather than increased with time. And renewal revenue started to become from 5 to 10 to 30% of the revenue. And as a result of that, we didn't have to raise funding, right? The customer's cash allowed us to keep scaling the company. And so that was because I was very patient in the beginning to get the product right and hit the net promoter score and the renewal rates. And then after that, I started to scale very crazily.
And I think that's Karan, that's actually a very, very important point. I think we see many, many good companies, one of the reasons why they don't achieve their true potential is because very early on, people get focused on building revenues for the sake of building revenues.
Right.
And some of those kind of things get so deeply ingrained that even... What's the right point to be? Pressing on the
correct.
Hey Karan, you're there?
Yeah, I'm there. Yes.
Great. Moving on to another aspect of product and content. So going back to the philosophy of delegation, and given that you are such a lean team for the early days, what areas of product and content did you get involved in early days, and how has it changed today?
It changed a lot today, obviously. In the early days, I think there's also a background, right? I was coming at the back of a pretty significant failure, right? So I was the Discovery CEO in India, and I actually did not succeed in the role, right? For a long time, Discovery, for the last 20 years in the company, was a very static company. They wanted somebody to come and take some big hits. And obviously they got some kind of a maverick from outside, and I came and I launched a big television channel. And it didn't work, right? And when I kind of analyzed the failure of what happened, the truth was that the product is the center, right? Around the center, you create a business engine and a marketing engine and a sales engine. But if the product at the center is hollow, then the engine around it slowly collapses like a house of cards, right? So in the Discovery days, I remember I had a feeling that, look, I've never done TV a production before. I've never shot a TV show before. So let me delegate that, right? And I delegated it to people who were smart, right? But my learning was that the product that we launched in Discovery was not good, right? And as a result, the entire engine that I created around it didn't work. So when I came kind of smarting out of that failure, right, in this in the startup, right, I was very clear that, look, the product is the center, around it is the engine that you create, and that product has to be excellent, right? So till the time, in the beginning, I was very involved in the curriculum, and I also learned that you just have to ask the right questions, right? I didn't need to know coding. I didn't need to know curriculum. I didn't need to know education. I didn't need to know tech. I had neither an education background, nor a coding background, nor a tech background. But I just knew that you just had to keep probing and asking the questions. And so I was very involved in the beginning, till the time that the machinery got set up, if you will, right? Till the time, we had done about 25 classes each, right? We had set up a machine of how the product would be created, right? In which there would be consumer feedback built into the creation, everything. Once the machine was set, then I stepped out of it.
And today you kind of, are there aspects which you're still watching closely? I know you have obviously a fantastic team.
Now I would say, Like I would say what I've done is that I've taken the, like I've given all the variable functions, if you will, with scale, with scale, right? Like sales, operations, etc. I've given it to the chief operating officer, and I do the fixed functions, if you will, product, tech, marketing, etc. So now I kind of have delegated in that line because, that's how we've kind of set it up. So I'm quite involved right now, I would say, in product, tech, marketing, curriculum, reasonably involved.
Yeah, and I also know that pedagogy was an area which was very close to your heart.
Yeah. Yeah.
How it is, I would say, important aspect is how it is communicated back to the parent, and White Hat has obviously done fantastic innovation in that area. I know that as a consumer of White Hat also. So that's a great job. How do you, on a related point, how do you, as a founder of a company which is doing so many different things, any framework you use in terms of balancing multiple initiatives at the same time? Like at any point in any founder journey, there are multiple things going on. How does one think about
it? I think I'm quite simplified in that. Right. So I think in the daily morning data review, but in the night also before I kind of sleep, in a way, I kind of step back a little bit and say, okay, look, what are the three things that we can do here that are really going to transform, right? And in some way or the other, I try to simplify my life to those three things, right? So in some form or the other, it's almost like on a daily basis, I'm asking the question on what are the two to three things here that's really going to change the game versus a lot of the busy work, you know?
Got it. And then
obviously all of the work has to happen, but what are the two to three things that I at the top of the company have to think in order to change the architecture of the company? And that helps a lot, right? Because just so that you know, right, if you remember, right, we went from 1 crore to 2 crore to 3 crore to 4 crore. We were going like that month on month, right? I remember stepping back a little bit and saying that, look, why am I doing this, right? The product has great response with the CTO coming. My tech is very stable. And I said, look, we should not be thinking like that. We should be thinking completely 10x now, right? And we went from like, after we made that decision, right? We doubled every month, right? We went from 7 to 14 to 28 to 56 to 112. And we always felt that, look, like I was very clear that we have everything. Now let's keep doubling every month. But if I hadn't made that decision, you would just get sucked into the normal. And you'd end up spending your time like that, right? Because you're then micromanaging the small things. So it's all like when we set the bigger vision, we were solving the bigger problems.
Right. So this is a good segment to another team-related point. And I see some questions in that area as well, that typically when you're, as the company is growing very fast, obviously new team members need to be onboarded, and some of the early team members are great, but some of them might not be able to cope up with the pace of scale. So any learnings there, or any framework there you've used to, because I've seen many founders struggle with this topic emotionally, especially with the early employees.
I mean, first signs of things in the sense, you have those so let me put it this way, right? You see the pebble which is about to become a rock, which is about to become a landslide, right? The moment you see a pebble, you should act. So I've done this multiple times, right? I hired a CTO on top of the VP of engineering. I hired a CEO on top of the VP of ops, because they were all excellent folks, right? But we knew that the scale is becoming so significant, right? So you start to see the pebbles, right? The moment you see the pebbles, you have to act. If you avoid the pebbles, they'll become the landslides, right? And in a startup, the people make the company, right? Processes and product, the processes and the systems are made by the people. So the people are everything. So I think I'm constantly looking at the pebbles, which are about to become landslides, right? And the moment I see a pebble, I act, because I know there's going to be a 2 to 3 month period to find the person. And then the person comes just as the time it is about to become a landslide, right? And that's great, because then they save us from that landslide. But if I acted at landslide, I think the company would crash, you know?
So you're saying while it might be sometimes emotionally difficult, but you need to start, be proactive in this area. Otherwise, it can hold up.
Very proactive in this area. And you can see the signs of people not being able to cope, right? You're able to see that. Look, and it's not out of lack of intention, right? I think in every case that I've been on like this, right, the people have been trying their best, right? They've given their heart and soul. But the problem has just become suddenly very big, right? And hard, right? Because of the scale has increased, or the complexity has increased, and you can sense it. And then you have to act very quickly.
So on a related note, I'm sure this is a difficult choice which as a founder, as an entrepreneur, one has to make in one journey. What are some of the other difficult choices you had to make along the way, Karan?
I would say on a fundamental level, we were very ruthless with ourselves on unit economics, right? And like, see, when we were sitting in reviews, right, and people would say ki wo acha investors ko dikhane ke liye ye hum log fixed cost mang sakte hain ye wo. I would always say yaar ki you can do all this stuff, right? In the end, the business is the business, right? If you're not running a positive unit economics business, then as you scale, the hole is going to get bigger and bigger. So I think a lot of decisions we made on right at the time when the business was peaking, right? Revenue was like, the model was working. We had raised Series A funding. That's the time I doubled the pricing, right? I've done a lot of things, right? At that time, I doubled the pricing, probably allowing a lot of players to come in at half the price because it was such a good price. But I was looking at the business, I was saying, look, the unit economics will never work out like this. The gross margin can't be 30, it has to be 50. 55, right, in order for the CAC to justify. So I feel like in many times we made calls like when the business was running stable and growing to kind of crash the, like to like really, like really take the risk on ki we are gonna like get the unit economics right, right? So I took the pricing up 50%. Then I could remove the call center, forced us to do a lot of automation work that we had to do right at the time when the momentum of the business could be lost. And we kept doing that at every point of time, right? And I think they were very tough. And now it doesn't sound tough, like unit economics, theek kar rahe ho usme kya badi baat hai, but the problem is that they are very, they're very big at that time, right? Because suddenly I decided not to take on more. So we made the entire teacher recruitment team, for example. We stopped their teacher recruitment, right? Till we got the unit economics right. So we had a team of 50 people who was just sitting empty, frustrated with the company, the rumors spreading ki company band hone wali hai kya, despite the fact we had raised funding and everything was hunky-dory, because I knew that I shouldn't scale until the structure of the business is right. And then each time we do that, right, that we are in an international market, is doing very well, the pressure is that low-key, and everybody tells me that somewhat of that cliche, right, ki you take over the whole market, then after that you can adjust the pricing, but I haven't seen that work.
That never happens,
right? See, the thing is, and then, for example, we never had some teacher incentives and stuff much, but there were some things that had just become part of the company that we would give them something for opening the slots or whatever. We got rid of all of that stuff at the same time, right? We said, we'll double the pricing, we'll get rid of the teacher incentives, we'll run a pure, and we did that at a time when the business was doing very well, right? And it was a very big backlash from teachers, from employees, from this, that. But I stood very firm. I said, look, if you don't do this, it will come and hurt us later.
No, I remember our discussions, Karan, and this happened, I think, at least 2-3 times in our journey when the revenue of the company actually in successive months degrew. And I think all of us knew right. The reasons why it was degrowing, and we were like very comfortable with that. Whereas right. I don't know how many other founders would go into a panic mode when that is happening, and rightly so for the reasons. But kudos to you that you did not let that impact you or your team in the wrong way.
So. Yeah, and I think, I mean, the credit is also, I think, like the board, right? I mean, you know, like, I think we had I think everybody wanted to build a structurally solid company. I never heard some comment around, okay, let's take over the whole market, then we'll worry about things later. You know, we weren't talking like that, right? The point was that, look, build a structurally solid company from the root, and there'll be ups and downs in that path. And so I felt very supported, right, at those decisions, right? I felt like, okay, it's fine. I don't need to demonstrate to anybody that the growth is increased 50% for investor presentation. I'm okay to say that, look, I'm down 10% because I was fixing the root of this business, and I've fixed the root and I'm going to grow again. And, and I think there was a lot of trust at that time for doing that.
Yeah. So surrounding you, you're saying that, and also your team members, I think sometimes it has a negative impact on
correct.
The team members as well. But I think you and your team were very emotionally, very secure with those kind of, I think those were pretty, I would say, very important decisions, because you cannot fix them at this scale. You could fix them only at that scale.
Yeah, no, I can't even imagine, right? So if you took, at that time, there were 300 teachers on the platform and we decided to take whatever small incentives we were giving off. Now there are 10,000 teachers on the platform. If I decide to take any incentives off, so right now we are running such a good economic structure that, like, you know, we don't have to do any of those things, right? But if I take any incentives off now, imagine 10,000 people.
Right.
Like the same problem is magnified now 30 times, So you have to take those tough calls very early before you actually scale. Surprisingly enough, I did all of that the moment the $10 million was secured. Right. That's the time I decided to kind of almost kill the business by doing all these things, because I was like, look, $10 million come in, then you'll be in the rush to spend, right? And then you'll be spending it inefficiently in a way. So I think unit economics is very important. And I think any discussion in which people are saying, oh, investor ko dikhane ke liye wo fixed cost bana do ye wo, usually your antenna should go up, right? Like you can do that. That's very easy. But eventually it shows in the business, right? And there's no way out of it.
Absolutely. So Karan, this is a good. We're going to take a short detour, I would say. If you're up with some rapid fire questions, to have a different kind of discussion, then go back to the more business like topics.
Right.
So I'm going to fire away an awesome but unpopular app on your phone.
So for a minimalist like me, I think Facebook is really a distraction, but it's still there. You know, I would avoid that distraction, but it's still there. Yeah.
Your personal favorite app built on the White Hat platform by a kid?
Good question. So there is a 12-year-old from Shillong who made an anti-bullying app, right? Anti-bullying app, right? She was being bullied in school. She created an app that you press a button and an anonymous notification goes to the headmistress. I thought it was very powerful on every level, right? That kid, very personal to the kid, right? Nobody else would have been able to come up with that idea apart from that kid. The fact that she felt that technology could empower her to do this, the fact that she actually created a workable product, which works to some degree, right? I think, like, I look at that girl, and she's 12 years old in Mizoram right now. I mean, I can just predict 10 years later, I'll be reading about her, you know? I mean, it's just like, for me, it's almost a given, right? So I feel very happy with stuff like that.
Yeah. Reading books or listening to podcasts?
Reading books, I read a lot, so yes.
One book that you would recommend as a must-read for entrepreneurs?
I think the whole science of growth hacking. So a lot of everybody reads hard things about hard things and all of that stuff. But I think the whole growth hacking movement in Silicon Valley, Sean Ellis and Brian Balfour, and Sean Ellis has written a great book on growth hacking. Very, very important for us as a company, right? We've always been thinking about how to reduce customer acquisition cost by tech. Right, how tech can reduce customer acquisition costs. So I really recommend that one. Yeah.
And last one, any new habit you picked up during the pandemic lockdown?
Not a new habit, but my yoga became very frequent. So I got very fortunate in some ways, you know, like with this whole thing that I was able to go back to my yoga more often.
Got it. Good. So going back to the business discussion, Karan. Thank you for that. How did you think about exploring other geographies? And you've also worked as a professional in other geographies.
Yeah.
So maybe a couple of questions. One is there a time when you would suggest that a company look at doing expanding into a different geography? And what is the difference between a customer in the US and in India? Two questions.
Here. Good question. So on the first one, I actually had a strong thesis, right? I wanted to be cash flow positive in India before going outside. Because my idea was that... you don't want to find too many battles with limited cash, right? So basically, if you have a particular reserve and you have too many open battles going. So the moment we hit cash flow positive in India is when we decided to go to the US, right? And that was kind of one, right? So that was for me, the trigger point was being secure in the business model in India, right? Because what I've seen with other people who've expanded very fast outside India, if the business model fundamentally is not secure or not strong in India, then you're just making the whole bigger all across the world, right? So that was the trigger point for us. See, the difference, I would say there are differences, but on the other hand, I would say there are more similarities than differences. Right now, a little bit was that I had lived in these worlds. I'd backpacked a lot, right? I'd taken a lot of years off to travel and stuff in the middle. My wife is not Indian, right? So in a way, I always believed in a very boundaryless kind of a world. So in a way, it was very intuitive to me that the product would work in other markets. Having said that, when you launch, I do believe that the first 100 sales calls should be done by the founder or in some form or the other. And every time you launch a new market, you should do everything on your own. We discovered some things which are very unique to our model, like that 6-year-olds are very comfortable with the laptop in the US. So we had to accelerate the beginner course, the grade one course, because kids were finding it very easy. Some things we learned were very similar. marketing, we learned a lot of things about how to market better in the US. So, but I did a lot of things hands-on in the, even after the in the US launch, right? So learned a lot about it.
Any big changes to the product or the approach?
As I said, the grade one course we accelerated because kids were very familiar with the laptop. Marketing wise, we had figured out that Indian parents were all about success for the kid. American parents were subtle, not to success, but mainly about the kid having the agency to choose something on their own, the joy of the kid choosing the product. Very different, right? The Indian marketing, as you know, is very hyper, the Indian marketing is very big and obvious kind of a thing, right? A lot of big success and stuff, while the American marketing is very subtle. It's around the kid finding joy in the product.
Got it.
Yeah.
So Karan, moving on to a question which I think I'm sure you get a lot of this these days on marketing. Some people love your marketing, some actually hate it. How do you think about it?
See, I had a philosophy, right? So I would always say that, look, the marketing has to be very big and obvious, right? Those are the words I'd always told the marketing team also once I had it, right? That it should be very big and obvious, right? Don't say small things, right? Say things that are very big and obvious. And then I also had another philosophy that, look, like a discovery should under-promise and over-deliver, right? Startup should over-promise and over-deliver. So over-promise, but then over-deliver against that promise, right? So if you're saying your kid will build an app, then make them build great apps, right? So just build over promise and over deliver all the time, right? So in a way, it is in line with my philosophy that it should be very big and obvious. So we say big things in marketing, right? We say that, look, you do coding, your life will transform. You do coding, you'll succeed. So we say, and then we kind of actually deliver it in the product. So in a way, I've never seen a paying customer, complain about our marketing. I've seen a lot of noise from everywhere, but I think we are saying in our own fun and exaggerated way, we are saying big and obvious stuff, right? And in a way, we believe that, look, we should overpromise and then overdeliver, right? We should not underpromise, because the startup will not survive if they underpromise and overdeliver. They survive if they overpromise and then figure out how to overdeliver that promise, right? So it's in line with that, right? So our current ad, which is causing a lot of flack, is that, okay, this kid, investors are fighting to invest in the kid's app, right? It's meant to be over the top. Funny kind of a thing, but people are reacting to it so literally, and but it was meant to be clutter breaking and
it's
doing the job, right? There's so much noise that I think most ads, the biggest problem is irrelevant. Nobody knows that all these ads are on, right? With celebrities, we have had most of the all the celebrities that have come to us are parents right now, right? Farah Khan is a parent, they're all parents of the product, and they volunteered to just say things for us. We didn't even get a paid celebrity, right? Everybody was talking about what the product has done for them. So we used them, and I don't know what the noise is about, to be honest.
You're saying don't feel shy about blowing your trumpet if you have a good product.
Startup should not, right? See, I think under promise and over delivery suits discovery, right? Startup should be over promising and over delivering, because it's too much noise, too little money. So if you are spending a dollar, it has to be equal to $5 of Pepsi, right? In the same period. So now your thing has to be 5 times more effective. So it should be big and obvious, That's why we are doing big and obvious stuff. And hey, by the way, we deliver on the product, right? So I would be worried if the marketing led to, at any point of time, my metrics are on, right? If the marketing led to people coming, not liking the product, refunds increasing, renewal rates going down, but all of the metrics have gone up, right? So once they come in, they like the product so much that whatever promise we've made is over delivered on that, right? So that's why I don't think.
No, okay, got it. I think that's a right way to think about it. I would say as a startup, otherwise it's very difficult to get rise above the noise.
The
thing is to have a good product, because if you don't have that, then
correct, exactly, yeah.
So moving on to the phase where a lot of excitement got generated around the company, which is around the acquisition.
Yeah.
There are a lot of questions. What made you? How did you think about when the offer came? Should you take it? Should you not take it? And what made you? What made you go?
I was actually, as you know, I was very clear right from the beginning that we should do it. Right. I remember you and I had a lot of friction about that. Right. But which I respected a lot, because I felt touched in my own way. Right. I felt that you really believed in the company so much. Right. You kept saying that, look. We had a lot of friction on that subject, right? But I thought that there were two things that were happening, right? One was I like Beju a lot, right? The moment I met him, I felt he had the same vision for the company, very boundaryless global vision. And in every form, he would support my intention on what I wanted to do with the company, right? So I never felt that I would be an employee who will have to bend to his wishes, right? I felt I would have my run to make it, to take it all over the world, exactly what I wanted to do, right? So that was one very clear one. I really liked him when I met him, right? So that was one, and I go with instinct on that a lot. The second part was that I think for startups, it's very hard to reach a point where the trifecta is accomplished, right? Where the acquirer is happy, the acquired is happy, the investor is happy, right? In a way, I mean, I think people are never fully happy, but the thing was that it was very rare that we had raised $10 million and we had hit a $150 million run rate. At $300 million, it was a bargain for Beju, right? Because it, or it supposedly, right? It was a 2x multiple in a very hyperinflated category. So, and yet I was happy because at $300 million, all the equity holders in the company were making significant money because we had diluted so less, given that we had raised only two rounds and at $10 million. And then I felt obviously the investors were making a very good return on their investment in a short period of time, right? Now, could all of these be better for everybody? Yes, but that perfect intersection of all three parties, finding a common ground, I felt would be unusual after that, right? Because after that, I would go through another fundraise, then there would be a $1 billion valuation, finding an acquirer who would be happy with a $1 billion valuation, right? Then, I felt like, look, this is the perfect intersection of all three states, and we should do it now.
Got it. Yeah. I think goes back as a founder to having clarity in what you're wanting to do. And yeah. I remember a lot of intense debates around it. And I think as board members and investors, I think one of our roles is to make sure that we kind of really encourage the founders to think about it in a broader way. And at the end of the day, I think we respect what you want to do as a founder. But I walked away from those discussions, Karan, sensing that you had thought about it very deeply and you knew what you were doing, which is what I think is the only way that you can take these decisions in the right way. So Karan, there are some personal related questions which I'm getting, and if you're comfortable, I'll
anything. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So I think one set of questions you're getting is you have this philosophy of doing new things every 4 to 5 years. How did ByteHat fit into that, or how did that get shaped before you started the company, and is that going to change going forward?
No, it's actually remained the same. So the thing is that there's a couple of different things that happen, right? One is that it's a bit of like I'm a little bit of a Buddhist, right? Not in the religious sense, but I read a lot of Buddhism and yoga and stuff, right? So I always have this feeling that I like beginnings and empty, a loss of identity, if you will, right? It's very humbling, right? To be a zero again, if you will, right? Important part of my thinking was that, look, I should not be an expert in anything. Every time I feel some level of expertise, I should destroy my life a little bit and become a zero again in a way, become very humble again. So that was a very enduring part of life in a way. So the moment I felt like, look, I've hit some kind of expertise in writing, I left it and didn't want to do writing again, right? At any a level I felt. So I don't like to be the expert. I like to be kind of a bit of a beginner, right? Always. So I think that, I like that idea of like climbing a new mountain, being fully absorbed in that journey of climbing a new mountain and kind of abandoning it at the top and starting again. Fits my kind of spiritual philosophy well, fits my interest level well of being very profoundly immersed in something, going very deep into it, but then not becoming attached to it in some form, right? So I don't want to be the startup guy and become a counselor for startups or speak in startup conferences. And this is part of the journey. I'll be doing it for a few years and then I'll become kind of a nothing again in some form. Yeah, so it's just a spiritual philosophy of sorts, yeah.
And how important is yoga and mindfulness I know it's been an important part for you personally. How important has been in building ByteHat and how you've gone about building?
I would say the associated things around the fact. So for example, I lived for a year in an ashram in 2012-13 or something like that, 2013, right? So it was an ashram in the Himalayas in Sivananda. It's it's cold water. It's in a forest, there are 50, 60 people in a room kind of a thing, right? So what happens is that when you are living in circumstances like that, right? You get very authentic to yourself, right? So in a way, So the thing, as a result, I've never bought a house. Even when I had money, now I could have bought, like, you know, I don't like, in a way, I like the, so as a result, I've just made very authentic choices. So when I wanted to write a novel, I had two kids, I was living in New York, but I kind of left my job to just write a novel for 18 months, right? Because I always had this feeling that, look, I can live on very little, right? And just the human needs very little to get by on, right? Because I'd lived like that for whether it's an ashram or traveling we went from Europe to India by road, my wife and I. So we had left. So I think it just makes you very authentic to yourself, right? So I was very comfortable when I was leaving Discovery that I'm going to do a startup, and it may or may not work, right? As is the case, but I knew that, look, I'll always be able to live on less, right? So I think that just makes you very authentic, I think, more than anything else. Yeah.
And Karan, how did you, and another question, how did you convince VCs as a solo founder? What's your advice to enterprise?
I think you should answer that question.
Why don't you start?
Right. So it's a tough one. I think it's not even, I don't think it's about the solo founder. I think most I think like you, for example, Anoop, I don't think the question is that, look, there's a pattern that two founders do better than one and all that. The question though is that in a tech company, not having any tech background, I do think is a barrier, right? I actually personally would also say the same thing, right? That I wish I had a tech founder, right? And the people I met in the beginning, I prioritize speed over everything else. So I was like, look, I'm going to move one way or the other. But I don't know how I convinced them. I think that's you should answer. But I don't believe that they were wrong in saying that you should have had a tech founder. Yeah. Right? I think you somehow sense that I would be able to find one.
Yeah, exactly. I think in the perfect world that is an important requirement. But life is not perfect, and I think as I reflect back on our discussion, there are two things were clear, became clear. One is that you have extreme passion for this area based on the philosophy you talked about, especially kids becoming from consumers to creators of technology. And I think as we got talking over a couple of meetings, it became clear that you would be able to attract those kind of people. So I think for us, what was as you alluded to, what was most important was that can you really build what you want to build? And I think obviously we got comfortable with that, and we got comfortable with the fact that we could support you well in that journey as your partners, feel delighted that you were able to do that.
Yeah.
Any other advice for founders, especially as they raise capital or as they are looking to work with investors? Anything you would like to share with them?
Yeah, no, I overall had a like, and I think Anoop, thankfully, you and I shared the same philosophy. I think the detail here is everything, right? The fact is that like I spent all my time on the business, right? So I would I would work very hard, right? For those who know me, I would, I had this, the same 10-10-6 philosophy, right? 10 to 10, 6 days a week. All of us would be like the team, the founding team. And then after that, we scaled up to 3,000-4,000 people, and we still have the same work ethic, right? The truth is that people waste too much time on investor coffees and networking. I think a good business attracts investors very easily. And if you don't have a good business, all investors are very smart to see through things. I feel actually that I felt that in the entire process of fundraising, people asked me very good questions. They could figure out that this was a fundamentally solid business. And we always had, when we were raising Series A, that whole thing happened in 1 week, right? Or maybe like in Series A, right, we had a couple of term sheets within a week of going into the market, right? In the subsequent, when we were trying to do Series B, we had interest within a couple of weeks, right? So it was because the business... The hard part is in just operating the business daily, day in and day out, without fatiguing, with full energy, and doing the unit economics correctly, building a great product that has that lowers acquisition costs because people are talking about it. And if that happens, I think the surround around it, investors come to you. Like I think you know what I mean. Like I think you don't over manage that process. And I think Anoop, you also always had the same philosophy that don't over manage it. You know, don't over network.
Philosophy aligned. I think that philosophical and meeting of the mind is very critical. Everything else works out over a period. Companies go through ups and downs. But as long as you are at philosophically on board with what is trying to be done and what the real parameters of success are, I think everything else pretty much falls into place. So I always advise entrepreneurs to focus on that topic a lot more than sometimes they do.
Yeah.
Great. So Karan, I know we've exceeded our time. I really want to thank you, Karan. Thank you for the privilege of partnering, giving us the opportunity to partner with you. Congratulations on all the success. And I know it's been a lot of intense hard work, which is not visible from outside, and feel proud of what you've been able to achieve. And good luck. Thank you.
And thank you for being such wonderful partners from day one. You know, it's been 2 years now since we first met, exactly 2 years. So great.
Yes.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you for joining us.